From Tally to Cali,
it's time to wake up!
Wake up! Wake up!
WarChant.com is your ultimate seminal sports source.
And this is Wake Up WarChant, presented by Zaxby's.
Now here's WarChant.com's Aslan Hudjavandi
and Corey Clark.
What up, everybody? It's Wake Up WarChant, presented by Zaxby's. I'm Aslan. Corey Clark will be joining us in the second segment as we roll out our final interview from ACC kickoff, and this is with Louisville head football coach Scott Satterfield. That's the second segment of today's program. Coming up here in a few moments, though, will be Michael Langston breaking down recruiting, talking about Saturday Night Live, SNL. It's the premier recruiting event for Florida State. It's going on this weekend. Michael will tell us everything we need to know about that event. Shout out to those of you who listen to the program, who tweet at us, who email at us, who post on the message boards, especially those who talk to us and tell us about their journey through the day at a Zaxby's. First off, I think Dattle Sensation, that's his name, Dattle Sensation tweeted at myself, Corey, Wake Up, and Zaxby's, telling us that he stopped in to try the Zaxby's Blackened Chicken BLT in Bristol, Tennessee. Now that's a tasty sandwich. Three shish kebab emojis and an American flag emoji. Also lets us know that Bristol, Tennessee is home to Dolly Parton, Miley Cyrus, Tina Turner, Megan Fox, and Quentin Tarantino. That's strong. That's strong. Drew Singletary also tweets at us, nothing better than wings, tenders, and celery and toast. He's got the whole box here. He's got the boneless chicken wings, and then he's got the tenders. I don't see the Zach sauce. He's going with honey mustard and ranch. Lots of celery, but I'm not a big celery guy. But he's got plenty. It's crispy. It's green. It looks great. And, of course, the crinkle fries and the Texas toast. It was a good lunch for Drew. I can almost assure you of that. All right, so we're going to have Michael coming up here in a few moments. Did want to mention a little bit of maybe a false alarm out there on social media. Jordan Travis tweeted out at some point on Wednesday afternoon, let's go! Probably seven or eight O's in the let's go. So everyone's like, oh, what does that mean? What does that mean? Ira reached out to the sources, knocked on some doors, made some phone calls. There's nothing official on the waiver yet for Jordan Travis, but it does sound encouraging. We might know something later this week, maybe even when the show is dropping and you're listening to it, maybe something will have been confirmed. But Travis went ahead and actually deleted the tweet after a few minutes, so it looks like nothing is official yet, according to the sources that Ira spoke to. Things are proceeding along in a pretty encouraging manner, but again, nothing is official. When it does happen, I'm sure WarChant.com will have the very latest on that. All right, so let's talk about recruiting, and for that, let's bring in Michael Langston. All right, this man has just been burning the midnight oil, burning it at both ends, just burning the house down pretty much. Michael Langston, going to break it down for us here. Saturday Night Live's coming up this weekend. I guess the first thing I want to talk about, and this was a question that was in the recruiting chat that's up on the website and YouTube right now, Michael, but somebody had a good question. Just basically, this is such a big day. This is such a big event. There's so many kids on campus. Like, how is it possible for this, you know, how is it possible to give all the kids all the TLC they want on a visit like this?
Say that again.
How is it possible for, like, you know, 40 kids to come to campus all pretty much in the span of, you know, 2 days, and for this staff to give them all enough kind of love, give them enough love and attention to really make an impact? But they've got a plan, I assume.
Yeah, I mean, they have a plan for every kid. I mean, they've done study. I mean, they have different people helping out in the support staff and administration that certainly, you know, help in a lot of these areas where they don't have to do everything. But there's a schedule for each guy, like what kids like, what kids are, what things we need to focus on, what key points they need to focus on. And so they go through that, and they have something for every kid. So they have a schedule for every kid of what they're doing, which kids are on tours, which kids are on academic presentations, which kids are out around the players. And then also they spend a lot of time in the position stuff with, say, receivers. Receivers spend a lot of time with Dugans. These are all guys that were invited, you know, that were sent, you know, golden tickets, as they call it. So they're these guys, majority of these guys are techs. So they're going to spend a lot of time and be much more detailed. This isn't junior day where you have a few guys that come in there that they're interested in, but you don't know how serious they are. These guys are, they're pretty serious about all of them. So they're going to get some detailed time so they know everything is and knows as far as experiencing what life is like as an FSU football player. And that's, and they have a plan for each one. So they have a lot of people behind the scenes that do a lot of stuff that help them, accomplish that.
All right, well, let's get right to it. I mean, there's a huge, expansive list right now on the premium recruiting board over on warchant.com that Michael's put together pretty much with every player that he's been able to sort of get a hold of or get some sort of confirmation will be on campus. We'll try to keep it focused on kids that are in this 2020 class, obviously some exceptions to the rule. But first off, Jeff Sims, the quarterback for this class, will be at SNL. And in your estimation, probably will be the only quarterback in this class, you think, Michael?
I would say at this point, that would be my feeling, that he's going to be the only quarterback, and he's been the guy that's kind of the catalyst that's put this all together to get a lot of these guys that you see on that commitment list. I mean, he's a big part of that because, quarterbacks, that's the leader of the team. They look about him, and they look at him, and he's very charismatic. We spent a lot of time with him, me and you, Aslan, just a very charismatic kid. Didn't come across as cocky, but just a guy that you can see why recruits like him so much. He's just a fun guy to be around. Loves FSU, and having him there this weekend is going to be big for a lot of these uncommitted guys. And he's out there when you work out and the performances and the event and the camp, to play with him and kind of see just how good he really is. I think that's going to be big. So having him there is a big deal.
Let's keep it at quarterback. This might be one of the only kids we'll talk about outside the 2020 bubble, but with obviously understood reasoning here. But Shador Sanders, son of Dion, we are thinking he'll be there. Just how good is he? And what do you think the staff wants to get accomplished, or what would you think Sanders wants to see on a visit like this?
Well, I think the big thing for Sanders is this is his first chance to work out with Kendall Browse. So he's never worked out with him. He didn't go to the June. He wasn't at June camp, and he hasn't had a chance to. Now Browse has watched him, but he's had a chance to just work with him, run the offense, and just get a feel for what that offense is going to look like in person with a workout. So I think that's the biggest deal is seeing what his comfort level is with Coach Browse and get the feeling of that. I think he's very comfortable with the FSU campus, the culture, all that stuff. I'm sure his dad, Deion Sanders, is certainly raved about, the type of person Taggart is and type of culture is. And he's been there two or three times, so he knows what that's all about. So I don't really think they need to sell that. I think it's just the comfort level with the guys that would coach him. And I think a lot of that signals around, Kendall Browse, and FSU is certainly one of the schools that's pretty very high on his list. Obviously, he's got a lot of other schools, Alabama, Georgia, a lot of schools that are certainly heavy in the mix for him. But this is a chance. I think if you're talking about one goal that FSU wants to accomplish, they need to come out of this thing. They don't need to, but it would be beneficial for them to where Sanders says, or we get the feeling and you hear the vibes from me that FSU feels that they're clearly a favorite. And I think if you do that, that's really mission accomplished.
Running back, no Jalen Knighton. However, there will be a bevy of guys, including 2021 commit Keyshawn Spencer. But Keyvon Lee, Dejon Edwards, these are a couple of the guys that will be there. Is Lee starting to emerge as maybe one of the top targets at running back for the Noles right now, do you think, Michael?
Yeah, I would say Lee is, and I think the only hang-up there is just his mom hasn't seen everything. I think if mom's on board, I think FSU feels pretty confident they're gonna pull this off and get Lee. He's supposed to go to the FNL Florida event on Friday. I think he's supposed to be Supposed to be a midweek visit to FSU, so probably tomorrow. I would assume that he will visit check out FSU with his mom. So that's really it's not about him, because I think he really is really high on FSU. I think it's about how mom thinks and how comfortable she is about FSU as a program, and if they accomplish that, that's why I put him on commit watch, just in case that happens and they sell on everything. They hit on all the points they need to. So I think that's the big key. But first of all, we got to see if he shows up and if he makes this midweek visit or if it happens later. But either way, he's a guy that they've been pushing pretty hard for.
I know this next guy, you kind of have him listed maybe more as an athlete than a running back. But Keziah Holmes, a lot of, held breaths around him right now. But it sounds like he will be on campus. How much ground do you think Florida State can make up in a weekend like this, and just how much is he still in play for Florida State?
Well, they trail, and it seemed like Penn State has a solid lead, but it also seemed like FSU had a solid lead before he visited Penn State officially. So, things can change. The good news about Keziah is he's already visited FSU twice. So that's a good thing as far as being familiar with everything. And now he gets to go to this event and he gets to see what this offense is actually going to be and in person. And so that's a big deal. And he spend a few days there and see some stuff that maybe he hasn't seen with the connection with the players. That's the thing you don't get on most unofficial visits that you get on official visits, which is probably why he raved about Penn State so much, is probably spent a lot of time with the players. And that's kind of something that I think FSU probably wants to harp on and hammer down of what the players are like, because he hasn't talked about that much when he visited FSU. So I think that's probably something that they're going to hammer over. It's possible, but there's a good amount of work to do on this visit. But if they don't visit, you ain't got a chance. So they're getting them on campus and at their biggest summer event of the year. So if you're FSU and this kid's committing like a week or two after this, you couldn't ask for anything more than a chance.
A lot of pass catchers will also be there. Carter Boatwright, tight end, Florida State commit. Isaiah Dunson, commit. Ja'Kai Douglas, a commit. Malachi Wideman, a commit. But maybe a commit watch issued for Brian Robinson, do you think?
Right. He's probably the guy. I haven't heard that he would do something or he wouldn't do something. He's probably the guy that I think's the closest, because out of all the guys I have on commit watch, he's probably the closest, because I felt like he almost did it on the last visit right after he decommitted from Miami. He's not a guy that needs to take a lot of visits. He's not I got to take a bunch of visits. He's not real big on the recruiting process. He's doesn't talk a lot. He's kind of quiet and his answers are pretty short. So, he's a guy that I could see if everything clicks and he feels that comfort again and that home feeling like he has the previous times, I think he's a guy that could jump on board. And I think FSU sits in a solid position there. And he's a guy, out of all the guys, he's probably the guy I'm watching the most.
Michael Langston, recruiting analyst for WarChant.com, joining us here on Wake Up WarChant. What do we know about Willie Taggart Jr.? How likely is it that he comes on board? What kind of limbo, if any, is he in, or is he a take?
That's an interesting one. I'm not confident he's a take, but I actually like him. That's why I listed him as an athlete, because I actually like him more as a safety, because I think he has I think he could do some things and have a bright future at safety. Quarterback, I've watched him several times, and it's just I don't see a guy that's like a can't-miss guy, and it's a guy that's going to take a while to develop. But maybe, we talk about that second quarterback. Maybe, they roll the dice and say, you know what, this is a developmental guy. Maybe we can do some things with this guy, and we know it's going to take some time, but maybe we'll do that. But, maybe that's how they look at it. Right now, I'd be surprised if you take, but I'll also say this too. He's very popular around other national recruits. They know him well. He's got a good persona about him. Guys like him. But that's an interesting one. I just based on appearance and me watching him, I don't think he's the fit for them at quarterback. But you never know. You never know. He might go out there and he can play another position. And you never know. It might be one of those surprises that they decide to take a risk on and roll the dice and maybe make their second quarterback. But I like him more as a defensive back, but that's just me.
Offensive line, obviously, a huge, huge area of emphasis for this class. I guess, you know, Zane Herring, a commit, will be on campus for this event. But right. I guess two guys that really everybody wants to know about, Thomas Schrader and Isaiah Walker. Schrader, I guess, at one time thought to be a heavy lean to Florida State. That's somebody they obviously want to try to gain some ground back on. But it seems like Isaiah Walker might be the most dynamic, most talented guy on the board for the Noles right now, you think?
Yeah, I would say that. I think Thomas is more important just for the now because they've got to get a tackle in this class. I mean, they've got to get one. I mean, they need something to get the ball rolling. They have no tackles in this class, and they probably need to sign like two or three in this class. So they need something to get the ball rolling. Thomas seems very close. FSU's been on him a long time. Louisville made a push. He officially visited there, and they made a big impression. And then, you know, now he's coming. He came visited FSU after that Louisville visit. Now he's coming back again for the SNL event, which is big. And I think they need to close the deal. I mean, this is the weekend. They need to close the deal. They need to get this done and get him on board. With Isaiah Walker, he's an interesting character because he was like, we talked earlier this week, and he wouldn't confirm to say, oh, I'll be at FSU. He said, yeah, I really want to surprise some people, so I'm not really revealing. I'm not telling anybody where I'm going to be. So could be at FSU, or he could be at Maryland or Florida, or he could be anywhere this weekend. So we'll monitor to see if he makes it. FSU's confident he'll be there. But as far as overall skill set, yes, he's the highest guy that you definitely want, and he's one of the best offensive tackles, you know, in the state and probably in the Southeast. So that would be a massive job if they could somehow pull that guy in this class. They have work to do to catch up. Miami leads, and then followed by Florida, and then FSU. So they're probably third right now. But yeah, you get them in for a big weekend like this. I think that's a big deal. And I think if they don't get him in this weekend, I think it's looking likely that he won't be in this class, and probably either Miami or Florida. But that's why this weekend is so big to have him there.
On the defensive side of the ball, defensive tackles now starting to come into focus as a position of concern for some of the fans. But this, especially after Alabama was able to scoop up one of the guys that was highly right. sought after with Timothy Smith. What do you see at defensive tackle spot? Obviously, Manny Rogers is a commit. He'll be on campus. Is Jerzan Newton maybe one of the top sort of options right now that will at least be on campus this weekend?
Yeah, I think it was a big deal of them getting Manny. I mean, that really kind of what I talked about offensive tackle. They got the ball rolling there. You really only need two or three of the defensive tackles in this class, and if you can get that, you're good. Newton looks very likely for FSU to land. That would give you two. So I think FSU sits in a good spot with Newton. Besides that, I don't really have a ton of names yet. There's guys on the hot board like Montre Edwards and a few others, but there could be some new guys that emerge that end up playing the defensive tackle / defensive end. But for now, I think the focus is on Newton.
Jerzan Newton's a 3-star defensive tackle out of Clearwater Central Catholic High School. Moving along on the defensive line, there's some commit watch guys, obviously, with Braden Swinson, Morvin Joseph. Maybe you can talk a little bit about one of those guys. But I think, obviously, Savelle Smalls is the most intriguing guy on the defense, maybe in the entire weekend, just because of that 5-star designation that everybody really loves to see. He'll be on campus, we're thinking, and just, you know, how good of a player is he? I mean, I know people want to know maybe about just how much of a legitimate chance Florida State has at him, but a 5-star, number 7 overall prospect in the country from Washington State, just outside of Seattle, or not just outside of Seattle, a little bit ways out of Seattle, but just how good is Savelle Smalls, and really how legitimate a shot does Florida State have right now in the month of July with him?
Well, he's a very dominating pass rusher, first of all. I mean, that's what makes him is so good, but he's also physical enough where he brings a lot of physicality as far as the run support. So his pass rush skills is what really is elite, and that's what, you know, people love, and that's why it's big that FSU is getting him. If you want to get him on campus, this is the event you want him at. You don't want him at the junior day. You don't want him at the spring game. You want him at the SNL because he can actually work with the coaches. He can see what Coach Odell does as far as his coaching techniques, and see the environment, what it's like, and get a full gauge of the environment and his feeling of, hey, can I play for this guy? Is this a coach that I feel the most comfortable with as far as the way he coaches? And so we already know he visited last spring, so we already know he really likes Taggart. He really likes what they're doing as far as changing the culture. Obviously, you need to see stuff on the field as far as a product. That'll help them, but he's a guy that will help you if you go out there and win and show a winning program. That will have a big effect. We saw that last year in a negative way with Kayvon Thibodeau, that it hurt FSU's chances because it's such a bad year. But I think his interest is realistic. I think he's fairly high on them. I think Alabama's probably, I mean, that's the team that I heard the most, but he kind of evened things out as far as being a little more open as far as all the other schools. So I think Alabama, Oregon, those are some of the main teams that are in there. But I think FSU is, and we talked about this on the recruiting chat, you ain't traveling all these miles just to go somewhere, just to have fun. I mean, he's legit, realistically and genuinely interested in FSU. And I think FSU just needs to show the other things that they haven't shown as far as the football and the football aspect of things, and also academics, what they offer academically.
Michael, we could sit here for another 50 minutes probably and talk about all these kids, but we already did that pretty much on the recruiting chat. So, yeah. I mean, just any sort of last thought you have maybe about the defensive side of the ball, or just what this weekend means, or what you're curious to see happens when the dust settles on the second Saturday Night Live.
Yeah, I'm curious to see how many commits. Obviously, that's always the first thing. I think we talked about Smalls. Morvin Joseph's a guy I'm really eyeing. I think he's a possibility to jump on board. He's formerly committed from Florida, but I think there's a lot of connections with Odell. He likes the defense, and so I'm kind of eyeing that. But I'm also eyeing just, when I'm around watching this SNO event, I want to, and the feedback I get from families and recruits, and I want to see, is that buzz still there that they feel going into this season with FSU? Do these families actually leave adding Dugans, adding Browns, adding Clements? Do they see a big difference in FSU, and do they really genuinely believe that they're going to turn this around and get it going the right direction? I want to hear what the feedback is from the families. That's kind of my thing I want to be looking for.
Thanks again, as always, to Michael Langston. If you want more recruiting information, go to the Premium Recruiting Board. It's there all the time, 24/7. Everybody talking about recruiting nonstop. Also, there's a video. It should be on the Premium Recruiting Board. It's probably on the front page of warchant.com still. It's probably on our YouTube page as well. But over an hour and 10 minutes of myself and Michael, that aforementioned video that we mentioned, it's all there if you want more recruiting. And then this weekend, as things start ramping up, be sure to stay connected to warchant.com for the very latest news, notes, information, video. We'll have practice video. We'll have interviews, all that sort of stuff from the Saturday Night Live recruiting event. And we'll see how many recruits actually end up verbally committing to the Noles on the day. We're going to talk football, the real thing, with head football coach Scott Satterfield from Louisville. But first,
the universe is a big place, so you should feel especially lucky you ended up on the same planet with Zaxby's. And right now, we're cooking up our special Cajun Spice Blackened Chicken for our Cajun Club sandwich and Black and Blue salad. It's an intergalactically delicious taste experience, and you don't have to travel light years to get it. The Cajun Club Sandwich and Black and Blue Salad, only at Zaxby's.
You're listening to Wake Up War Chant, low-carb beer for the Seminole soul. Back to Aslan and Corey.
Okay, we're back. It's Wake Up War Chant presented by Zaxby's. The interview with Scott Satterfield, head football coach of Louisville, coming up here in just a matter of moments. But wanted to remind everybody, if you're going out to Jacksonville for the Boise State game, August 31st, 2019 kickoff, maybe get to Jacksonville a day early. That's because the Jacksonville Seminole Club, along with the Florida State University Alumni Association, are coming together to throw the premier event for that weekend, and it's going to be going on over at Surfer the Bar in Jacksonville Beach, Friday, August 30th at 6 p.m. It's called Spears and Cheers. That's the name of the event, Spears and Cheers. Jacksonville Seminole Club, one of the best Seminole clubs out there, along with the FSU Alumni Association, throwing this party. It's going to be crazy. We'll all be there. Myself, Gene, Ira, Corey. I almost forgot about Corey. I still love you, man. We'll all be there. You need a ticket, though, to get into the event. And for that, you got to go to Seminoles.com/kickoff2019. Seminoles.com/kickoff2019. Get you your ticket. Again, all of us will be there, including Corey, who I left off at the last moment. I'm sorry, Corey. But he's going to talk now. He and I interviewed Scott Satterfield at ACC kickoff, and here's how it went. Welcome back to Wake Up War Chant. Aslan, Corey here in Charlotte. Still, we're sitting down now with the Louisville head football coach, Scott Satterfield, who joins us here on the program. Coach, thanks for taking the time out.
Appreciate you having me.
A little bit different than Sunbelt Media Days, I imagine?
Yes, it's a little bit different, you know. But, you know, it's not a lot of the same questions, though. You know, it's just a lot more people around here. And, you know, and a bunch of teams that I'm very, you know, familiar with. As you know, I grew up in Durham and then, you know, ACC country. And so it's cool for me to be a part of this and to be in this league.
How does a guy that, you know, from Durham, played ball at App State, hung out in Boone, yeah. had a roommate who's from Banner Elk.
Oh, yeah.
So, How does somebody experience such great success in North Carolina decide to – when is the right time, I guess, to then go elsewhere?
Well, I mean, I don't even know if it's ever the right time. You know, I'm 46, and I spent 23 years in Boone, you know, and so half my life. And a lot of blood, sweat, and tears at App State. And, you know, and I did – you know, I walked on, I earned a scholarship, and I coached a bunch of positions and a head coach. So I did pretty much everything there at App. And then we had a great run, you know, in the Sun Belt, three straight Sun Belt championships, four straight bowls, and then – you know, you got an opportunity to be a head coach in the ACC, and, you know, these things don't come lightly. They don't come around a lot, you know, where you actually got an opportunity. Somebody offered you a job. So, you know, if this is what I wanted to do, obviously could have stayed at App for a long time. But, you know, in my mind, I felt like, you know, listen, how much more can we do there at App? You know, we've won so many games, and I love it there. But I want to have an opportunity to try to go compete for championships, national championships. And I think in this league, we know we can happen. I mean, Florida State, Clemson, these guys have won national championships. And so, you know, now we're right here in the middle of it. So it was just a great opportunity. And Louisville's a great town and a lot of great things happening there.
You walked on in college?
I did.
So, but you won the job. Like, you became the starter.
I started my last 3 years.
Yeah, so yeah. – What gave you the confidence that you could do that? Were you, was it a preferred walk-on? Is the, I guess, the
back,
nomenclature we used today?
Back then, listen, it was August 3rd, 1991. And back then, we had 55 freshmen come out back then. They didn't have numbers back in 91. And so, hey, if you want to walk on, you come on and walk on. They didn't have, like, preferred back then.
Right.
And I was just another guy. They didn't know my name, you know. And but I just, you know, just being a little bit persistent and hard-headed and probably, you know, stubborn, and you just go out there and you take it day by day. Next thing you know, hey, who is this Satterfield kid, you know? And I was on scout team my first year,
right?
And then Coach Moore put me on scholarship the following year, and I was third team, and then as a redshirt freshman, and then ended up starting my redshirt sophomore year. So you know, it's really what dreams are made of. You know, here's a guy,
yeah,
just a walk-on nobody, you know, from Hillsboro and Orange High School. Next thing you know, I'm sitting in the head coaching chair at Appalachian State. You know, flash forward. I mean, it's crazy, and now I'm coaching the head coaches in ACC. I mean, it really is crazy, but it just proves and shows that, if you just put your head down, work hard, things can happen for you. And, you know, I'm a great example of that, just because I had my wildest dreams, never thought you'd be right here, you know. And so, And I'm just humbled to be here, and so I take every day as a blessing. I work my tail off to get here.
What was the if you were the coach on the other team? What was the scouting report on Satterfield, the quarterback? Big arm,
mobile. I was more of a runner.
Okay,
we were a running football team back then. Handed the ball to the running back, but my senior year, I think I rushed for about 750 yards.
Okay.
In '95. Right. Not much of a passer. Looking back, I was terrible, really, actually, passing the ball. but with my senior year, we went undefeated. So we were 11-0 my senior year at App. And,
was Randy Moss playing in the conference?
Randy Moss was the year later. He was in 96.
Right.
So it was
there you go.
We missed him. Terrell Owens was the same year as me. So
there
he played at Chattanooga. So we played against him every year. We beat Chad every year, too. But he was a good player. Yeah.
Coach, you know, we're from Florida State. We cover them primarily. The last two football coaches, if you include Willie Taggart, Jimbo Fisher was an offensive coordinator, then took over as head coach. Taggart kind of comes in blindly. How much different is it going to be? You were at App State, and then you had a good idea what you were inheriting. And then into Louisville, walking into something you really don't have an idea.
Sure.
I mean, what are the challenges that those two sort of scenarios present?
That part is really challenging. You know, and as a guys, and this happens every year. So, you know, all these coaches that end up taking a job, you don't even know what you're getting into. Like, you have no idea, really, you know. And
do you research?
You don't have time. You don't have time to research. We played our game. We were a Sun Belt Championship game on Saturday. I met with the AD on Sunday, and then offered a job on Monday. Like, how do you have time, you know, to find out, like, all right, what's, you know, what kind of players do they have? You know, what's going on over there? Was anything bad? You know, you have no idea. You look at their tradition, and you say, man, they're probably pretty good. They just had a Heisman Trophy winner, and, you know, a couple years ago, they were almost, you know, playing for, you know, close to the ACC championship, you know. So that's all I knew. And then you get up there and you're like, well, that's a different story, you know. Yeah. I mean, so.
Lamar Jackson's not walking through
exactly. We need him back, you know. Yeah. So, but it's just, you know, these things you don't know when you take the job. And now, once you're in there, now you got to figure it out. You got to say, hey, here's where our needs are. We got to have this. And then you work toward that. But, you know, we got to rebuild. It's going to be, you know, there's a lot of things that's got to happen there in order for us to have any kind of success. But it all starts for us with the culture and rallying around that. And to me, that's how we're going to measure success this first year is, you know, attitude and effort and what kind of things we're putting in there. Wins and losses, who knows, you know. But it's all about the daily process of that attitude and great effort every single day. And then hopefully, to me, that'll be successful if we can do that every day.
And how do you go about – well, you haven't – I mean, you haven't done it yet, but how do you go about changing a culture?
Well,
we hear that all
the
time.
No, well, I know it. Everybody throws it around. Well, it's on a daily basis. It's being consistent every single day. You know, you lay out a plan. Here's what we're going to do, guys, and then they're going to see how you are every day.
Right.
All right. How do you react every day to everything? That's how you lay out the culture. And then you're presenting things to players and our leadership groups and all that stuff. And I want a player-led team, so it's going to be filtered through our players, everything that we're doing. And I just believe if you got players that really believe and care and have pride, then they're going to have a hard time getting beat because they're not going to quit. They're not going to lay down. They're going to protect their brothers. And so that's where it starts for me. We're laying the culture out. Same thing we did at App. It's the same plan we had there that they're going to have here.
And they're not kids you recruited, most
That's
of
right.
them. So
no, they're not.
How do you know when they buy in?
Well, we had – when we first got there, probably the first 3 months, we had about 14 or 15 guys that left. So I knew they wasn't buying in.
They sold, yeah.
You know. So everybody else, I assumed, and stayed, hey, you guys ready to buy in.
Right.
So, and then we've had one or two along this journey here the last 4 months that maybe said no. But the guys that are here this summer, these guys are busting tail. I mean, they're doing what we're asking to do. They're bought in. They're into it. We're going to have some times this fall where, you know, it's going to be doom and gloom.
Right.
All right. Now, how are they going to react then? That's where, as coaches, we got to be right there to say, hey, guys, keep doing what you're doing. Let's keep going. We're going to be there. It's a bump in the road right now. So it's an everyday thing. You can't do it one time or say this, and all of a sudden you're changing the culture.
Mm-hmm.
It takes about a year and a half.
Right.
To really get your full culture. It's a lot like, you know, Coach Taggart at Florida State. I mean, he just got there. He's been a year. So, to me, about midway through this season, that's going to be their true culture, you know, because it takes about a year and a half, I believe, to really firmly get it in there where everybody understands where we're coming from.
Head football coach of the Louisville Cardinals, Scott Satterfield, joining us here on Wake Up War Chant. Coach, how much of a more challenge of it is it when you have kids that a lot came to Louisville for the success of Lamar Jackson? They're used to what Louisville has been, and this isn't kind of what they sign up for. Is it harder to turn those kind of guys around? Is there any sort of entitlement kids like that feel when they come to
the
university?
I think it's probably a little bit of that. And I think, but it's our job as coaches to say, you know, that everything's earned, nothing's given. And you do that on a daily basis. I mean, yeah, there's no question. Probably some of them said, hey, man, we're going there. They're good. They're won. They're going to keep winning, you know. And it just don't happen that way. I mean, you gotta work every day extremely hard. You know, even Clemson now, who's, you know, one of the best teams and probably, you know, will be again this year. I promise you, they're working as hard as anybody out there. You know, you have to, because everybody else is trying to beat you, you know. And so nothing's going to be given. So you just have to reiterate that, I think, on a daily basis to say that you have to earn it. And you have to earn the respect from everybody else.
Did you know how close the stadium was to Churchill Downs?
No. I heard somebody said it's, you know, literally right across the street. I was like, okay, whatever. I thought they meant down the street. But
right.
It's literally right there.
It's there. It's almost like a part of campus.
It is. Yeah. It is. And they use that parking lot of our stadium on when Churchill's, right, you know, going on. So it's great. We've been several horse races over there.
Okay.
Since then. They're racing all summer, too, on the weekend. So,
did you win some money?
No, heck no. I don't know if anybody wins. You may win. Hey, you may win at some point,
yeah,
but then you're going to get it back.
Yeah, you're giving it back.
You're going to give it back.
That's how they build those places.
That's why you don't bet much. You bet a few dollars here and
sure,
there just to have a horse to pull for.
Yeah,
you know,
that's right.
It's fun. It is a lot of fun.
Is rebuilding things, does it differ on the circumstance, or do you just do what you do and what you're used to doing?
No, I think every situation is different. I think, you know, now we have our core that we're going to do, you know, but you can tweak here and there. And I think, and particularly X's and O's side, I think, so as coaches, we got to look and say, all right, where's our strength? Let's really amplify those strengths. Don't ask somebody to do something you can't do, you know, so you certainly got to do that. You know, I think that's huge. I think coaches get in trouble when they say, all right, this is what we do regardless. You know, that's where you get in trouble a little bit. So you got to tweak here and there, you know, work on your strengths there. But like the cultural piece of how you run your whole program, I think you can do that. I think you can certainly do that, and from your daily things. But the X and O things, you got to tweak. You 100% got to tweak because you don't know what you have until you go start working with these kids, you know. And then now, as you start recruiting, you recruit to what you want and all that. But that takes time in order for that to happen.
Do you call plays?
I do.
How important is that for you to – I mean, you're bringing a lot of new guys on offensively, the coaching chemistry, so that your offensive line coach knows how you want these plays blocked up. Is that a difficult transition?
Well, our O-line coach was with me for the first 4 years of that. And so he helped me with that transition there, and we're on the identical page. He was at NC State the last 3 years, did a great job there with their offensive line.
Yeah.
Gunnar Brewer's a receiver coach who was at North Carolina, which I know him well. Stu Holt coached with me at App, so he's on staff there. We're all on the same page. We all know, you know, here's what we got to do. Somebody's got to call it. You know, it just happened to be me, you know, because I like calling plays.
Yeah, exactly,
that's fun.
Exactly.
But we're all on the same page as far as throughout the week when we're game planning and we're talking. They know what we're going to run, and they got a great feel for it. If there's something that they don't like, a position coach, then we'll throw it out, you know, so we won't run it. And so we're all on the same page, and then somebody's just got to call the play. I've always worked that way, believed in that, so it's a good working relationship. So
music at practice, coach?
Absolutely.
Really?
Absolutely.
Okay.
We started that when I was got the head 6 years ago at App.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice. It's making its way around the country.
Yeah, we've been doing it for a long time. I you know, our whole deal, one of our core values is have fun. You know,
right.
And I think, and we're in a day and age where these young people, they listen to music all the time, right?
Sure, sure.
If you go on a college campus, everybody's got the things in their ears.
Yeah.
You know, everybody's listening to music. So that's why not do that at practice?
They don't even know what birds sound like anymore.
No, they don't. Or they can't really talk to each other either. But
that's right. That's right.
Know. Louisville head football coach Scott Satterfield joining us here on Wake Up War Chant. Thanks for your time, coach.
Appreciate you guys. All right. Thank
you very much.
Thanks again to Scott Satterfield, head football coach from Louisville, for joining Corey and I over on Radio Row when we were at ACC kickoff. Yeah, I think if he gets 9-10 wins in season 3 at Louisville, I think he's going to get a lot of calls to go to places that pay a lot of money to coach football. And I think a lot of schools in the SEC would want a guy like him leading their program. So we'll see. Hopefully none of his wins come at the fortune, or the misfortune rather, of Florida State. That's the last show of the week for you folks. We're going to come back on Monday. Michael Langston will join us again. He'll wrap up everything that happened at Saturday Night Live. We'll see if there's any commits to talk about and kind of what happens next for Florida State as that dead period gets close to beginning. Corey will be back. We will talk about football. The season It's almost here, folks. It's crazy. So we still don't know exactly what day practice is going to start as of the recording of this show. We still think it's going to probably be the second. So we'll talk about our hopes, our dreams, our aspirations, what we maybe forecast seeing with this team once practice does start. But then we'll most likely take the remainder of the week off, and then we'll go full bore, I think, around August 4th. We'll be going back five shows a week, getting you ready for football season. But we will be back on Monday. We'll wrap up Saturday Night Live. We'll kind of set the table for practice when it does start, either on August 1st or August 2nd. But in the interim, there probably won't be any shows going on. So we love you. We're still here. Tweet at us. Email at us. Go on warchant.com. Use the promo code WARCHANT30 to become a part of the ultimate Seminole sports source. For Corey, for Michael, I'm Aslan. Thanks for listening. Have a great weekend, everybody. We'll catch up with you all on Monday.
WARCHANT.com is the ultimate inside source for FSU football and recruiting. And now you can get in on the action for free for an entire month. WARCHANT.com is offering a risk-free 30-day trial subscription. Get full access to the number one website covering the Seminoles just by entering the promo code WARCHANT30. That's WARCHANT30. Sign up and get in on the world's most active FSU message boards. Receive breaking news, stories from our award-winning staff, plus get exclusive interviews and videos. Just enter the promo code WARCHANT30. WARCHANT.com, your ultimate Seminole sports source.